stay.
Good morning, this is Kay Adams with you till 12 on BBC Radio Scotland. It is Tuesday the 30th of April and the race is on to find a new First Minister of Scotland after this happened yesterday.
I'm so blessed for having the opportunity afforded to so few to lead my country. And who could ask for a better country to lead than Scotland?
Well, after 13 months in office, Hamza Yousaf has resigned following the collapse of the power-sharing arrangement with the Greens. Speculation is, of course, rife as to who will take over, but while we are waiting for things to happen, let's assume that anything could happen. If the... Who would you choose? 80295. Still to come. Everybody wants to be... East Kilbride missing cat mystery. Maybe we could enlist the help of this guy.
A team skeptic.
Oh, that's Danny Robbins, host of the Uncanny podcast.
Another sunny day, another bright blue sky. Another day, another young brother died.
These are the blue things sky out my window, but our own Mr. Blue Sky, a.k.a. Brian Gilmore, will be bringing it to the studio with his property surgery. If you have any questions at all about property-related matters, then he is here to help. Give him a call or text 80295. We've all pondered this one, haven't we?
You come to the medicine aisle and you're overwhelmed between generics and brand names. For cold medicine, ibuprofen, pain relievers. So is the generic as good as the brand name?
Well, should you go for branded or own label? We will find out. And first clue for Name the Place coming up next.
On BBC Radio Scotland.
In our Name the Place quiz, this is our treasure hunt on the radio. I've got six clues in front of me, all devised by Professor Carol Huff, Professor of Onomastics at Glasgow University, and they should all lead you to one place in Scotland. We now have an easy-peasy clue, clue number six. I'm looking at it. I don't think it's peasy. I think we'll just go for easier clue. It's got a musical link, actually. It's an interesting one, but anyway, that's not coming till 11:30. You've got the tricky ones to wade through before you get to there. When you hear this... That means that somebody has got the correct answer. That is, of course, the clever klaxon. So let's get going. Here is clue number one. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. There you go. That is clue number one in today's Name the Place quiz. 80295 is the text number. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. All right, we'll be getting into the East Kilbride cat mystery.
Shut up in my bones.
like you do. Oh no, to love me like you do. Ain't no man got a little woman like me. You got all the loving, honey, one sweet girl can claim. You're every poor boy's dream.
Well, it looks like it's a bit tough on the old name the place because we don't have any guesses at all. Clearly, you are rather perplexed out there with that first clue that I gave you. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. It sounds nice. Might not make any sense, but it sounds nice. No, hang on. I spoke too soon. We do have some guesses coming in. By the way, just on the fantasy First Minister, we're going total fantasy now. In fact, ignore the 129 MSPs that are sitting in Holyrood. Just go absolutely blue sky thinking. Go wild card. Andy in Dunfermline is going for Irvin Welsh. That would be his fantasy First Minister. And, Ross from Peebles is saying, I would like the next First Minister to be a man who gets things done. And that man is, wait for it, folks, wait for it. Hang on. Are you ready? Are you ready?
On.
Nigel Farage. But, if we can't get him, Boris Johnson. There you go. That's Ross from Peebles there. Keep them coming, your fantasy FMs. But anyway, I was talking about name the place. I got distracted there, didn't I? Can I throw in Billy Ocean? The first clue, today's place name refers to two topographical features. The Kelpies in Falkirk, a good guess. It's wrong, but it's a good guess. Eric from Pullman is going for Jura. Blair Drummond, that's from Anne in Menstrie. And Sterling comes from Susan in Kirriemuir. Strike them off your list. They are not correct. It's not Sterling, it's not Blair Drummond, it's not Jura, and it's not the Kelpies. So there you go. They are gone. I'm going to leave you with that one clue for just a little while longer. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. Kelpies was a good guess, wasn't it? 802. 295. Can there be such a thing as a good guess that is wrong? Can there? Not really, because it's wrong. Anyway, and keep your fantasy FMs coming in too. 80295 is the text number for both. Now, when Tracy McCulloch's cat went missing, Peppy, by the way, she was puzzled to find it miles from home in Motherwell. When she found out that another cat had also been found there, in fact, I think there was up to 9 cats that had been found there, she thought it was plain weird, and her daughter Sam set up a Facebook page. Tracy is convinced that something untoward is going on, and it's a mystery that the Sunday Post described as the Bermuda Triangle. You get it. So Tracy and Sam McCulloch are with us now. Good morning, Tracy and Sam.
Good morning.
We also have with us Roger Tabor, who's a cat expert, former BBC Animal Magic presenter. Morning, Roger.
Morning.
Good morning. Listen in, Roger, till we hear what happened. We'll get the SP on this. So Tracy, tell me what happened with Pepe and when you started to think, oh, this is a bit odd.
Literally, you open the door, you say his name, and he's there. This particular morning, he had the vet, and we couldn't find him. So we went to the vet with our other cat, thinking, right, he'll be there when we come home, and he wasn't. It was totally out of character. So that kind of, we're worried from that point because he doesn't go anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So we kind of started looking around the area, shaking biscuits, checking sheds, garages and things, and still nothing. So it kind of started looking through social media. Mm-hmm. My daughter Sam phones at the time, so just in case he'd been hit by a car, different cat places, cat and dog homes. We even visited them. But through doing searches on social media, that's when we discovered there had been other cats found in kind of similar area, like Newark Hill, Holytown, Motherwell, just all these kind of, in that kind of area.
The Bermuda Triangle.
Yeah.
And how far is that from where you are, Tracy?
I don't know.
Miles?
About 25 minutes drive.
Right, okay. I don't know, 10 miles, something like that? 7 to 10 miles?
Yeah. So we spent 6 hours plus a day putting posters out, chatting doors, just constantly on social media. And then it was starting to come a light that there was other cats, like I said, from these found in these areas from East Kilbride as well. So that's when Samantha set up the page.
Right.
And there's still people getting in touch now.
Right. So you found Pepe, yeah?
Yeah, 16 days. 16 days. A woman said he was in our... Well, we had had a few calls saying sightings in different areas which were followed and nothing. So we weren't holding out much hope, especially through there.
Uh-huh.
And we thought, well, wait, we went the following morning, first thing in the morning. We actually found him within 5 minutes.
Right, OK. And Sam, it was you who set up the Facebook page, so you start getting messages in. And when did you start to click that this wasn't just Pepe?
Well, actually, when we found Pepe, because I remembered just recently somebody in the greenhouse, like, which is close by to us, their cat had also, I think it was roughly about 6 weeks or something, maybe 9 weeks, kind of thereabouts. So I looked into it further, thinking it can't be a coincidence that there's been more.
Right.
And then from the Facebook page, there's been, like, I mean, even now, like, with the paper going out the other day, the number was at 9, but it's, like, even more now.
So a bunch of cats individually, all about from around your local neighbourhood, are all found in this area, which is, what, it's 7 to 10 miles away? Yeah.
Yeah, all of them.
Right, OK. Roger, does that sound odd to you?
Yes. I obviously have to take it as at face value, and I'm not doubting Tracy for one second. But I know it is very easy for an owner to misidentify a cat because it's very similar, and particularly well, you're wanting to find them. But putting that as a sort of proviso behind us, on the assumption that these are all real, and with Tracy's case, it's completely unambiguous because the cat was blind in one eye, I understand.
Yes, that's so true.
Thank you. So to go from East Kilbride, the 9 miles across to that triangle, getting on towards Motherwell, of small communities, which are very, very close together, and crossing the Clyde, it must be said, if you're getting a group of them, it's almost impossible. If it's one, yes, because most cats, I can give you numbers if you like, but basically it makes more sense if I say it in terms of how it relates to you, because there isn't an exact number for a house cat's home range, the area they normally live in. And if it's a female cat, it's normally your back garden and a little bit on either side, which if it's high density housing, it's about 0.2 of a hectare, which probably doesn't mean anything to most people, but half an acre. If you're a male, it's anything up to about 10 times more. But it's not this sort of distance. And the other key thing is these are all in one direction. Mm-hmm. They would just be randomly going, if you were having a mass exodus,
yeah.
They wouldn't all be going in one way. So these things, if they're real, it points to somebody who is living in the place where they're ending up and working in East Kilbride and going backwards and forwards, because particularly with the Clyde as a crossing area, it's very hard for cats to get across, and they're not going to travel those distances. You get the odd one who will roam, but, realistically, mm-hmm. this is not standard by right. any means. So, yeah, I think somebody's up to no good.
Right, so your money would be on somebody deliberately transporting these cats to this other location. Sam, have you picked up any other clues, any other sort of common features of what's happening?
No, we have spoke to a lot of the owners individually, and to be honest, there's not really... I mean, you can't accuse anybody.
No,
there isn't any evidence to say
please
it was anybody.
Don't.
We can't. No. So there isn't, there isn't anything other than they all went missing from the same area and have all been found within the same area.
Right. Okay. And unharmed?
Yeah. So none of them have had any injuries apart from obviously being absolutely starving and,
Right. Okay. And have they been found sort of just generally in the street by other people that have been alerted by your Facebook page or?
Yeah, so most of the time it's been people posting, there's a stray cat, does anybody recognise it, and through sharing it, that's how most of them have been found. I know a couple of them, it's been somebody local has found them and took them to a vet, and their chip is obviously what's found their homes.
Right.
So a few of them it's been their chips, but a lot of them has also just been through Facebook posts that they've been found.
Right, okay. And Pepe, when you found him, was kind of skinny and underfed, but happy to be home, I imagine.
Yeah, he was very nervous for a while, but just really underweight.
Mm-hmm. And have you contacted the police at all?
So I haven't personally, and neither has my mum. We have, because of the group, obviously so many, a few people have done, but because there's no evidence and there's nobody that we can say has done it, so unless we have proof of somebody actually being seen picking the cat up and doing it, there's nothing anybody will do.
Right. So, unfortunately, it remains a bit of a mystery at the moment, but presumably everyone around your neck of the woods is being very, very watchful as to what the cat's up to.
Yeah, so obviously a lot of people now have Ring doorbells and CCTVs and stuff in the house. So it's just now just trying to kind of have everybody checking them and putting together, see if we can kind of find a pattern. But again, it's not something we can do unless we can prove anything else.
Mm-hmm. Well, listen, thanks very much for telling us about it. I'm really glad that Pepe is safe. Sam McCulloch and Tracy McCulloch there. And thanks very much to Roger as well. I didn't realise that cats had real kind of habits like that. I always presumed, as someone who has never owned a cat, that they wandered hither and thither, but they've got a pretty kind of confined range, really.
Yeah, it's very much so. And it's totally dependent. It's like a slide rule. And the density of human housing, then you get closer in groupings, the wider it is. For example, if you're up on the highlands somewhere in isolated cottages, then the ranges will be that much bigger. So it's very much a sort of sliding scale as to where you are. That's why I say it's very hard to say an exact amount. But if you're going from high-density housing, yes, we can give the amount. But it's not going to be these areas. If I lived in East Kilbride, I would make damn sure I had my cat chipped.
Right. Yeah, well, that's a very sound advice. Sam's saying there that a few of them have been picked up by being taken to local vets and they have been chipped. Roger, thank you very much indeed. That's Roger Tabor, who's a cat expert and former BBC Animal Magic presenter. We're still getting your suggestions in for Fantasy FM. Elaine C. Smith and her Two Doors Down role, Christine, that's from Francis in Glasgow, that's a good one. And Jim fancies Liverpool manager Jurgen Klopp. That would get things moving, he says. What about you? 80295.
One big weekend's coming up with lots of great bands live. It's two full days of mayhem, so let's hope that we survive. Chris Moyles is going to Scotland, he'll be live there in Dundee, with 20,000 people rocking out in the marquee. The Chris Moyles Show, we're on our way to Dundee. Spray.
Hey, Dom, it's...
Ewan McGregor, fancy him? Fantasy FM of Scotland. You can go absolutely anywhere you want this morning, except Holyrood. We did that in the phone-in. Now we're having a little bit of a blue sky moment. 80295 for your Fantasy FM. And also, of course, your guesses for Name the Place. It's getting busy now. Our first clue, today's place name refers to two topographical features. Loads and loads of guesses coming in. Drumna Drocket is a really popular guess. Fraser and Kilwinning and many, many more going for that one. Inverness, Forth and Clyde Canal, Lomond, that's from Mike C in Tayport. These are all wrong, of course. Strike them off your list. Joan and Dunbar's going for Benderloch, Rock Cliff. Fits the clue, says Tom the Hat. It may do, Tom, but unfortunately it is not correct. William also going for Benderloch. Hill of Teviot, that's from Alison in Kilmartin. And Drumclog is Quigley's guess. This is wrong. Well, I'll have to rattle on through them. We've got loads of them. Kirkintilloch, Fort on the Hill, at my dentist there now, says Ian Wright. Thanks for that, Ian. Hope it's not too painful. Janice from Nielsen says Bridge of Weir, Drumlarnig. That's another guest being chucked in. Gorebridge says Carol. Bannockburn, that's from Alison. That's Alison Kilmartin again. Aberdeen says Angus and North Hugh is Drumclog. Drumclog is a very popular guest. That's from Neil in Giffnock. Cannock, that's from Lynn in Aberdeenshire. And John and Ellen says Name the Place. Sorry I'm late. That's all right, John. It's OK. Join in when you can. How about Ballantrae again? If that's wrong, let's try Stonehaven. They two for the price of one. They're both wrong, John, but never mind. Thank you very much for guessing. I'm going to give you another clue in a second. Torness says Ian Douglas in Ayr. Tom the Hat agrees with that, but I'm afraid I must disagree because it is wrong. Here is another clue for you. One of the features now shares a name with an elevated village in Fife.
If only I could get out of this.
BBC Radio Scotland.
Oh, we're we're doing good business on Name the Place today. It's very lively, very lively. That was the second clue I gave you. Building on the first, as Professor Karahoff often does, she often builds her clues. Clue number one was today's place name refers to two topographical features. Clue number two, one of the features now shares a name with an elevated village in Fife. Brian Gilmore is settling in for his property surgery. Given his knowledge of the country, he might... No, he doesn't. Could it be Ladybank, says Linda in Kilmarnock? No, it's not. Someone's suggesting, is it Pope of Glencoe? Pope of Glencoe? I'm not familiar with this place. St Andrews is another guess. New Gilston, that's from Eric in Polmont. No, I'm afraid none of those are correct. I'm going to hold off on another clue for now. Today's place name refers to two topographical features. One of the features now shares a name with an elevated village in Fife. That's both clues rolled together. 80295. As I say, Brian Gilmore for Indigo Square Property is here, ready, of course, for our property surgery, taking calls from 11 o'clock, though the lines are open now. Must impress that upon you. 0808 592 9500, or you can text, of course, 80295. That is also the text number for your Fantasy FM. Brian, it would be you for me. Of course it would.
Obviously.
Obviously.
And anybody who disagrees with me would be wrong. So.
Yes, they would. They would.
I was actually just thinking... Professor Carol Huff would make a good First
yes.
Minister. She could introduce legislation and give people clues as to what it's
yes.
going to be. And no one would know. I would be none the wiser until the police pull me over one day because I've been in breach of the legislation.
And then you'd get a prize.
Yes.
It would be wonderful. A klaxon. That's what you would get.
Yeah, the police would pull me over, wave the klaxon.
Bring the fun back into politics. We do have some suggestions in. Leslie and Sterling's going for Nick Nairn. Well, you know, food, our yep. diet is a very important factor of life. Simon Inverness is going for Frankie Boyle. That would be interesting. Mm. David in St Andrews is going for, it says, I would vote for Lord Buckethead. He usually has some good ideas.
Well, as a football fan, he's wanting to get rid of VAR. So I'd be in favour of that too.
We have Jurgen Klopp as a suggestion. I don't know if that would be to your liking. Alison Argyle says, I like this one, Marty Pellow, maybe not a great politician, but look, good at question time. you can keep those coming. 80295. So let's talk property. What's it looking like for first time buyers right now? Because I think the last time we spoke, you were saying that that's the kind of feeder to the market. And once the first time buyers are kind of going, then the other elements of the
yeah,
of the
obviously
market,
if you think of it as a big giant circle,
yeah.
the circle of housing life, where the first time buyers come in and they move people on to the family homes and then the bigger family homes, and then people downsize and that sort of circle. So you need that feeding through of first-time buyers to make a market healthy. And the challenge for first-time buyers, if you look at average house prices, this is across the UK in the last 20 years, the challenge is that wages have risen at 112% and average house prices have risen by 200%. So you can see what the challenge is immediately. Mm. In fact, I was looking at something the other day and I came across the first flat that my wife and I bought.
Mm.
And it was £42,500 it cost us.
When was that?
1998.
Right.
And that flat, the flat above, sold about 6 months ago for £228,000.
Wowza.
So that... I think the version of my wife and I today would not be able to afford a £228,000 flat.
Mm-hmm.
So that, to me, sums up the challenge that first-time buyers are faced with. Slightly better in Scotland. Average first-time buyer price in Scotland across everywhere is £135,000. But, of course, again, the challenge we've got is increasingly... I mean, I always go on about the Firth of Clyde because I've got a friend who's a headmaster down there, and I lived there 40 years ago, lived in West Kilbride 40 years ago, and just off the top of my head, I calculated there's 100,000 fewer jobs in the Firth of Clyde than there was when I was a wee lad living down there. And the jobs are now concentrated in big cities. So although Scotland-wide average house price for a first-time buyer is £135,000. In Edinburgh, for example, first-time buyer average price is £290,000. So because the jobs are concentrated in Glasgow and Edinburgh and Dundee, there's a bit of light in Aberdeen if you're a first-time buyer in Aberdeen.
Well, yeah, I think it's £102,000, £602.
Yeah, so somebody like Aberdeen, a bit more light, not so great, because the only reason that's the case is because house prices have been falling consistently in Aberdeen. But it just shows you that the challenge for first-time buyers is if you want to be close to where the jobs are, that's the problem, that the prices are rising there, although it's not as bad as the rest of the UK.
And what are the challenges in terms of getting a deposit, meeting mortgage payments, etc.? Because there was hope that mortgage prices costs would have come down by now, but that's not looking...
No, in fact, three lenders this morning have said they're going to put their rates up. Because what happened was, with inflation being better than expected in January, February, there was an expectation that the Bank of England would bring the base rate down sooner than had been expected in October, November time. And so a number of lenders sort of jumped the gun and pre-priced in a slight decrease in the Bank of England base rate. Now it's looking like that's going to be pushed back to the autumn, and therefore they went too early and they put their rates up a wee bit. So the challenge for first-time buyers is that the what I talked about earlier about wages not growing at the same rate as property prices. One of the other challenges for first-time buyers is a lot of them still need to make that move, need to move to where the jobs are, may have gone to university away from home and stayed there, and so they're living in rented accommodation. And of course, one of the things that we have seen in the last 12 months is that rents in Scotland in particular have grown faster than rents at any part in the UK. So the average age of a first-time buyer is just pushed beyond 30. So, but people tend to leave home about 24, 25 is the sort of average. So you've then got that period of 5-6 years where they're paying higher and higher rent, which means their ability to save that £20,000-£25,000 deposit for the mortgage, even if they're taking out an 80% mortgage or 90% mortgage, it's stretching out how long it's taking them to save up that rental deposit. So again, those first-time buyers with parents with cash are the ones who are fortunate enough that they're getting more and more help to get on the property ladder, with parents averaging about £20,000-£25,000 help to first-time buyers.
Well, we might get some first-time buyers calling in this morning. If you're in that situation, you want to speak to Brian and get some advice on what to do, then please do. But happy to take any questions at all about property, whatever situation you find yourself in. 0808 592 95 00. You can text 80295. Brian, we'll see you just after 11.
Thank you.
Is everywhere on BBC Radio Scotland.
Yeah.
Quick romp through some of the other guests coming in for Name the Place. Upper Largo is very popular. John's going for that, as is Marion from Livingston. Suitors of Cromarty. I can never say that. Cromarty. Why can't I say that? That's from Jean Cameron in Pooh. Glenrothes and New Gilston. That's Linda and Kilmarnock. Findhorn. That's from Marion King. Usey. Cooper Angus and Bannockburn comes from Vicky in Lanarkshire. Strike those off your list. I promise you I'm going to have another clue for you very shortly. Now, when Ali Mason received a diagnosis of autism as a young adult, a lot of things fell into place, including why she had struggled with travel in the past. With her new insight, she was able to put together a travel kit to smooth her path a bit, and she has now written a book called The Autistic Guide to Adventure. She's with me now. Good morning, Ali.
Morning.
Good morning. And also joining us, Fiona Atherton, who's the author of the children's book, The Boy Who Loves to Lick the Wind, and she's a mum of two, including a child with autism. Morning to you, Fiona.
Hi, Kay.
Good morning. So, Ali, you love travel. You know, it's something that's a big part of your life. What was it about your diagnosis that made you think, I can see my previous challenges differently?
Gosh, that's such a big question.
I'm sure.
I think that primarily it was probably the sensory aspects. So I always kind of struggled with being oversensitive to light and to sound and things like that, but never was able to label it that way, if that makes sense. So I was struggling, I was finding things difficult. People around me were noticing that I was finding things difficult, but I wasn't able to explain, it's because the sun's too bright, it's because I'm too warm, it's because it's too loud here. So having that, you know, that way of explaining things post-diagnosis has been transformational, both for me understanding myself, but also helping the others who I'm often traveling with, whether that's family, friends, partner, to understand what it is that's kind of triggering me to be uncomfortable.
Hmm. And of course, when you're traveling, not always, but a lot of the time, you're going into strange situations, unpredictable situations. So, you know, it's not that easy to prepare, is it?
No, exactly. And I think it's one of the things that I touched on in the article that I wrote recently about travel, where the point of going to these places is that they are new and is that they are different. And that is kind of, for most people, a really fundamental part of why they decide to travel. For autistic people, I would say that it's really valuable when we can take our comfort zones with us, because it means that we are in a place where we're better prepared, if you like, for dealing with those new situations.
Fiona, how do you find it travelling as a family with one of your kids having autism?
Yeah, that's the right case. So my elder son is autistic, and I've got a younger son who's neurotypical. And actually what Ali was saying there about the sense of adventure, it was really interesting, because what we've noticed, I mean, holidays for us are absolutely not now about adventure. They're about managing anxiety and keeping things calm. So we go every single year now to the same place, the same apartment, the same place in Mallorca. We eat in the same restaurant every night. And although it's definitely not adventurous, I mean, our younger selves would have laughed at this idea, myself and my husband, but actually it keeps everybody calmer. And if people are calmer, that's much more of a holiday. It really is the small things being different. It's the cumulative effect of lots of small things. As Ali says, lots of sensory difficulties for my son, particularly with travel, so that can be really tricky. But once we actually get to the place, I mean, it's so funny, when I was talking to a researcher, I was saying, you know, there's an awful lot of pressure on day one of the holiday, because we're creatures of habit, we have to be. So day two and subsequent days will look just like day one. So if day one doesn't go well, you're looking ahead thinking, oh, Lordy, here we go. Mm. There's a lot of pressure on day one for it to be a good day.
So what do you do on day one in order to try and make sure that it is a good day?
Yeah, well, a lot of crossing fingers. No, what we tend to do is we don't rock the boat. Essentially, what we do is, you say, it's a place that we go to where we're now used to the surroundings. My son's used to the surroundings. And it's a very set routine of get up, go to the pool, come back, have a rest, you know, let the kids have some time out of the sun. And then we go to the same restaurant in the evening. He has a dip in the sea afterwards. We don't rock the boat, essentially. We wouldn't do it in a different order. It's that's not fair on him, and it's not fair on us as a family.
Hmm. You know, Ali, your book is The Autistic Guide to Adventure. So presumably for you, you are able to kind of push the boundaries a bit, yeah?
Yes, so I think it's really interesting what Fiona has highlighted, which is that every autistic person is different, and every autistic person is going to have their own comfort zone limit, if you like. So I'm very fortunate that when I go on holiday, I can go to different places each time, and there are still difficulties that I face whilst I'm there, but I'm not in the situation where I have to go to the same place every year in order for that to be kind of the limit of my comfort zone, if that makes sense.
And am I right in thinking you take a bit of comfort with you in the form of a kit?
Absolutely. So something that I developed since I got my autism diagnosis a few years ago is a, I call it my sensory kit that I take with me whenever I travel. And it's just to make sure that I have all the things with me that I know will benefit me and support me whilst I'm trying these new things and putting myself in these different situations. So I'll always have my sunglasses because of my sensitivity to light. I'll always have ear defenders or noise cancelling headphones for the sound. I can sometimes find it really difficult when there isn't food that I'm familiar with in the place that I'm going. And obviously for travel, trying new foods again is something that a lot of people really enjoy. And it's certainly something my partner enjoys. So I want to make sure that I can go to the places with him that he'd like to go so he can try those new foods, but maybe have a backup plan, maybe take something with me so that I know if I don't like it, I'm not going to be left, you know, hungry, and that in itself is a recipe for danger.
Yeah. Fiona, you were saying that once you are at your destination, it's familiar and, you know, everyone settles in hopefully nicely. What about the travel? I mean, travel has become increasingly stressful, the getting there, for absolutely everyone. How do you cope with that aspect?
Well, it used to be, actually, ironically, it used to be a lot easier, Kay, because before the pandemic, when we had travelled abroad with two young children, which can be stressful for any family, but actually the special assistance that we used to get at Edinburgh Airport, at many airports around the UK, was, I mean, truly phenomenal. You would apply ahead of time. You would fill in a sort of questionnaire about your child's needs or your needs, and they would... I mean, it was like being a celebrity. You were treated in the airport like a celebrity in terms of being whisked through places, and it was absolutely amazing and really life changing. In that, I know it gave families that we know access to travel. Since we've been traveling post COVID, as it were, and obviously airport cuts and everything, that service, it exists on paper, but it doesn't really exist. You turn up and there are no staff, and the staff will openly say to you, we don't have this service anymore, really. We don't have the staff to fulfil it. So actually, for us, airports have become really, really difficult now. Being on the aeroplane, my elder son loves, he's absolutely your dream traveller once you're on a plane, but in the airport, not so much. And that's become a real challenge that is a shame, because the special assistance can make all the difference to people.
We do have a statement from Edinburgh Airport, which is that providing support to neurodivergent families and passengers with hidden disabilities is important to us as an airport. We want all passengers to feel safe and comfortable when travelling, and we would encourage anyone who requires support to contact OCS using the details on our website. So just to report that from Edinburgh Airport. But I mean, Ali, I would imagine, well, I don't know. I mean, you've travelled extensively, Ali. The airport experience, is it generally difficult, or is there anyone doing it better than anyone else?
I completely resonate with what Fiona's just said, in the sense that I have had positive experiences at airports where I've been provided with the assistance that I need, and I have had not so positive experiences where I've essentially been left to fend for myself. I think the Sunflower Lanyard scheme is really positive, and I noticed that when I flew from Manchester Airport recently wearing my lanyard, the staff there were so proactive. It was fantastic. They went out of their way to make sure that I felt comfortable and I felt safe, and that I had the options available to me. Interestingly, I then, a couple of months later, flew from Heathrow, and that wasn't a positive experience for me. I didn't get any additional assistance and had to... I ended up actually taking myself to the corner of a restaurant and sitting with sunglasses on, ear defenders on, playing with a fidget toy, just trying to self-regulate to get through the overwhelm of the airport, because to some extent that is maybe not the hardest part of travel, but it's definitely, for foreign travel, one of the hardest parts of the autistic experience, is just getting from arriving at the airport onto the plane.
Yeah. I'm sure it is. I'm sure anyone can relate to that. But I mean, if you find these situations particularly difficult, it must be a very challenging situation to manage. But listen, thank you very much, Ali. Your book is The Autistic Guide to Adventure, which clearly, with your experience, hopefully will resonate with other people facing similar challenges. And thanks very much to Fiona as well. I wish you happy holidays when they come, Fiona. Enjoy that familiarity.
You can enjoy the world of beauty, excitement, and adventure. All these and more can be yours in the wonderful world of art. Here's how you can find out if you have the interest and desire needed to become a serious art student. You can test your artistic interest right in your own home with this art test from Art Instruction Schools. It's fun and challenging, yet easy to complete. And when you're finished, you simply mail it in. One of our experts will review and grade it, and that's all there is to it. To get your free art test without cost or obligation, call this toll-free number now. But don't wait, because the beauty, excitement, and adventure of art are waiting for you. To get your free art test, call this toll-free number now.
How about Sir David Attenborough as your Fantasy FM for Scotland if our next First Minister? We're still playing Fantasy FM. 80295, what do you think of that one? Somebody else is suggesting Rick Astley. He's never going to give you up. Thank you for that. That's from Ian and Dunkeld. Johnny Durlton says, oh, this First Minister chat, complete waste of time. Complete waste of time. Everyone knows that Scotland coach Steve Clark will be FM after everything has gone to plan in the summer. Well, we're all blooming well hoping that it does, Johnny. Well, that it goes to plan is what I mean. Name the place. It's very busy. We don't have a correct answer yet. Let me tell you to strike these off your list. It's not Newport, thanks to Mary from Mary Hill. It's not Penan. That's from Squirrel near Tain. It's not Falkland. That's from David Sorley in Anstruther. Loch Lomond, that's from Ian on the A9. Falkland, that's from Sandra in Glasgow. Muir of Ord, that's from Donald, who's listening in Spain. Jolly good. Muir means moorland. Ord means rounded hill. Both topographical features. Good guess. Unfortunately, not correct, Donald. Let me give you another clue. The other feature is quite a relief. Is clue number three. The other feature is quite a relief. So from the top, today's place name refers to two topographical features. One of the features now shares a name with an elevated village in Fife, and the other feature is quite a relief. There you go. That's your third clue, 80295. Remember, the easy peasy clue comes at 11:30.
Get in touch.
One for the money, two for the bank, three to get you going, cause the brat's in the place. Yeah. It's me, the OG Funk Bandit, the B to the R-A-T, and in fact, if you ain't heard of me, take a seat, lay back and listen as I bust for your ass on this funkified mission.
Just kick off your shoes and relax your feet.
That's right.
Party on down with the wet heartbeat.
Now it goes like that and that's how it goes. I'ma give it to all you Negroes and hoes. So listen up, make sure you listen up well. Don't miss a little bit cause this here be bad as hell.
The truth of the matter is I splatter kid.
Trying to diss in the gangster's way, that's how them fools get dealt with. So what you wanna do? Don't even trip.
Step up, step up.
And I'ma bust your lip. Now I know that you know that I know you don't want me to, but keep on tripping and I'ma give it to you.
Than the flow that I flow for you Negroes and hoes. Devastating, captivating, elevating. It's I operate, float, no cloud nine. So just
fight up.
your request. I guess it's time for me to hit the cut. It goes
1+2+3+4.
From the bottom to the top, top to bottom I go. So now you know what I ain't and what I is. It's the baddest little pimp in this hip hop biz. OG is what I am, a brat is what I. You know what I, and you can't see. So let it go, cause I'm wrapped too tight. Take it how I give it and enjoy the night ride. Yeah, it's like that. It's like that. For the 1994 is the brand. And you don't know, you better ask somebody. La-di-da-di, I came to party. Big baby. JD, what you think about this right here, boy? Come on, come on.
Word up. Hey. Word up. Hey. Word up. Hey.
For real, though.
Word up.
On BBC Radio Scotland.
Now, I'm sure we've all been there. You're standing in the chemist, you're looking for painkillers, and you're faced with a choice between the less than a pound own label version and an array of jazzier looking options at six and seven times the price, all promising instant results. Which one should you go for? According to recent research from Which, if you go for the more expensive version, you are likely to be paying for the packaging rather than the product. Shefali Loth from Which, a nutritionist, is with us. Good morning, Shefali.
Morning, Kay.
Good morning. What did you find?
So, as you said, we looked at a range of products that you can buy in the supermarket or pharmacies, health products, and found that actually, more often than not, the claims aren't really backed up in science. The example you gave was of painkillers. People may have noticed on the shelves there are painkillers that promise targeted release. They might be called migraine pain, etc. But actually, when we spoke to experts, they told us you can't actually target pain relief in that way. So really, the medicine inside is the same, and it tends to be ibuprofen. So the Nurofen migraine relief pills cost £4, but actually the same product in Tesco own brand generic one is £2.35, so you're just paying a premium for a targeted branded product. But actually, the own brand ibuprofen, which does exactly the same thing in Tesco, is only £2.25.
Right. I mean, targeting is something that you see quite a lot. Also, you know, works in a particular space of time, you know, works faster than anything else. Do you look into that?
So actually, some of those claims are founded. The doctor that we spoke to said actually ibuprofen lysine is more effective than just ibuprofen, and it has been found to work quicker. Some medications will also include caffeine, which has been shown to help with some pain relief when taken alongside paracetamol or ibuprofen. But again, you could just have a cup of coffee for that caffeine. You don't necessarily be needing to pay that extra for the product.
Mm-hmm. We've also got Laura Wilson from the Royal Pharmaceutical Society. She's Director for Scotland. Hi, Laura.
Hi there.
Hi. So what should the customer be looking for then?
So I think it's really important that customers know what it is that they want, and then they can what they can do is look on the packaging and make sure that the active ingredient, so the medicine itself, for example, paracetamol or ibuprofen, is the same in each packet. Then they can look at the strength of that and see, make sure that's comparable as well. And also the formulation. So obviously capsules are more expensive to make, so they'll be slightly more expensive. Tablets are usually the cheapest. Liquids, again, are more expensive. So the formulation that you want. But if all of that is the same, then I think you can be assured that the branded product and the generic product are the same. So and patients can just go in and ask pharmacies if they're not sure. The pharmacist will be able to advise on whether or not the products are the same and can usually recommend a cheaper option if that's what you're looking for.
Right. When you say capsules, you know, capsules, tablets, liquid, you get soluble tablets. Is that just down to your preference? None of those will necessarily be more effective than the other?
No, I mean, liquids and soluble tablets can usually work slightly quicker just because they're already in a liquid form. But generally, if the active ingredient is the same and the strength is the same, then you will get the same pain relief from that product. Mm. So it's really down to personal preference. Sometimes branded products might, you know, you might find one or you might find a product that you prefer because it tastes a bit nicer or it's got a coated capsule or a coated tablet. And if that's the case, then, you know, and that's the product you want to buy, then that's absolutely fine. I think what's important is that patients are making informed choices and that even if they're happy to pay more for a product that they want, they know that there's still a cheaper option there and they've not been told that this product is superior in some way.
Mm. So if you get a painkiller directed at migraine, as Chef Lee was saying, or period pain or back pain, are they likely to be that different?
No, it'll be the same product. When you take a painkiller, it works in your body, it goes into your body and is absorbed, and it will treat any pain that your body has. Painkillers work in different ways, so sometimes some are better than others. For example, ibuprofen treats inflammation as well as the pain, whereas paracetamol is better for a fever and pain. So the type of painkiller that you want to take is important for what you're trying to treat. But actually, if you take the same strength and product, you will get the same effect and it will treat every pain in your body, not just the one that you want.
Right. Chef Lee, and mindful of time because we're short, but so the price difference, though, is really significant, isn't it?
It can be, yes. And as Laura was saying, really, people just need to look out for those active ingredients and compare packaging to see if products are identical, and if they are, then they can just buy the cheaper generic brand.
Okay, well, listen, thank you very much for that. That's Chef Lee Loth from Which and Laura Wilson from the Royal Pharmaceutical Society. Brian is here for a property surgery after 11 o'clock, 08085 92 95 00. Any questions at all relating to property, get them in. You can text 80295. Keep your Fantasy FM suggestions coming in and I will give you another clue for naming the place. Seeing some brightness out there.
Really? I haven't seen it.
No, some brightness.
No, I don't accept that. I went down for my porridge after my early start and it was
no
too
brightness.
Depressing to go out. I've got my boots on, I've got my tights on.
Oh.
Not happy.
Well, listen, this will give you a bit of brightness. Mm-hmm. We've been asking people this morning who would their Fantasy FM be, and I'm wondering what you think of Eddie's suggestion.
Uh-huh.
Gene Simmons of Kiss in stage costume and makeup would work for Eddie.
Oh, well, yes. Oh, yes. I like it. Will I tell you mine?
Go on, yes, please.
Well, I've given this deep thought.
Yes, thank
deep,
you. Good.
Deep thought. Barbie and Ken.
Yeah, a double act.
And each day at the end of play in the Parliament, there's to be a